Ladies and gentlemen, I am John Pace, a member of the R.M. Santilli Foundation and the chairman of the World Lecture Series on Hadronic Mathematics, Mechanics, and Chemistry. It is a pleasure and honor for me to present Lecture 3A by Professor Ruggiero Maria Santilli on a truly fundamental scientific advancement, the axiomatically consistent and invariant generalization of 20th century space-time symmetries for systems with potential and non-potential internal forces. In this lecture, Professor Santilli also presents the universal symmetry for all possible locally varying speeds of light within physical media, whose achievement required the prior construction of the isotopic generalization of Lie theory presented in Lecture 2A. The generalization of 20th century space-time symmetries originated from the fact that the rotational symmetry cannot be exact in particle physics since there exists no rigid bodies in nature. Similarly, the Lorentz symmetry cannot be exact in the interior of the proton, the neutron, and other particles due to their hyperdense structure and for numerous additional reasons technically identified by Professor Santilli. The full understanding of this lecture requires the knowledge that the development of much-needed new clean energies and fuels crucially depends on deviations from 20th century space-time symmetries as shown in technical details in Level 5 of this lecture series. Ladies and gentlemen, allow me to introduce Professor Santilli as a true scientific leader who has dedicated his life to seek basically new scientific knowledge in all quantitative fields, a leadership that is now followed by scientists the world over.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Today we will present an outline of the universal symmetry of the most general possible reversible space-time. Please note something new here in the word reversible space-time. That the association was non-existent in the 20th century because all the space-time of the 20th century were obviously reversible over time, since they depend on the square of the local coordinates or their differentials. And so therefore, the all element of the 20th century, Lie element, were obviously invariant and over time reversible. Now, but this restriction, the beginning from the title, is necessary in our series of talks because when we pass to the Lie admissible covering of Lie isotopic theory, we will indeed have irreversible space-time, namely space-time characterized by a non-symmetric metric defined over a non-symmetric unit in which that will allow the axiomatization of irreversibility from the very foundation. Very well, so the topic of the lecture of today should be twofold. We shall discuss all infinitely possible isotopies of the Galilei symmetry and all infinitely possible isotopy of the Poincaré symmetry. Of course, I cannot do both because it will take a number of semesters to review all this material in details. In regards to the isotopy of the Galilei symmetry, I simply will have no time to discuss them at all. I proposed them for the first time in two books published in 1991. Volume 1 on the mathematical structure and Volume 2 on the actual isotopy. And the primary objective, as you can see from this picture, is that Galileo essentially studied the motion of body by ignoring the resistance of the atmosphere, so was studying exterior dynamical problem in our language. As you know from preceding lecture, we study interior dynamical problem. So basically, the isotopy of Galilei symmetry and relativity essentially deals with the leaf that moves in a wiggly way through the air from the Pisa Tower all the way down. And indeed, this essentially implies the incorporation of variationally non-self-adjoint forces. There are two additional books. The elements of hadronic mechanics that treat both of them, the Galilei and the Poincaré case, in great details. There are also a number of independent books. This is one by Professor Tsagas and Sorlas, and based essentially on Lie theory. It was published in 1991 prior to the discovery of the Ashen number, so it does not include the full isomathematics as presented in lecture 2b. But nevertheless, with that sole exception, it's very easy to do the upgrade and understand, and it is definitely a recommendable presentation. Another one that is recommendable on Santilli's isotopy of Galilean special relativity, which is very detailed and very readable. But the review which is very dear to my heart is this one by five colleagues that is essentially the lecture notes of my presentation of the isotopy of Galilei symmetry and relativity that I delivered at the International Center for Theoretical Physics in Trieste following an invitation by the late Professor Abdus Salam. I would like to spend one word to remember Professor Salam, because in my opinion was one of the very few and extremely rare true scientists. Indeed, he was committed to new knowledge, I had the first invitation of my life from Professor Salam, 1967, to present at his institute in Trieste to present Lie admissible algebra, and at that time what we were hoping to be a physical application. The lecture which I delivered in 1992 in Trieste were again also following the invitation by Professor Salam, and I'm told that those were the last lecture attempted by Professor Salam. Indeed, it was very painful for me and for him, because he was in the very late stage of his unfortunate illness. He could not speak, but I could see from his eyes the excitement in seeing new knowledge, new physics being developed, or at least attempted. I have no words to remember Professor Salam with great appreciation and, if I may say so, the devotion. Very well, so let's pass now to an outline of all infinitely possible isotopy of the Poincaré symmetry that in our series of lecture we call Lorentz Poincaré symmetry. Lorentz Poincaré because the Lorentz symmetry is the crucial and substantive part, as we all know, of what is called the Poincaré symmetry. So to honor both, we call it the Lorentz Poincaré symmetry or the LP symmetry. And here is the conventional expression. But immediately you see a novelty here. You see, as we will see, the Lorentz Poincaré symmetry is 11 dimensional, while throughout the entire 20th century it was believed to be 10 dimensional. We will see the origin of this, it's called isotopic symmetry. This is a lecture in physics, and I have to start by emphasizing a dramatic difference between physics and mathematics. In mathematical paper, I cannot be manipulated. They are based on theorems. They are rigorous. Sure, there is some politics in mathematics, but it is marginal and absolutely of no consequence, of which I am possibly aware or worth reporting during this lecture. In physics, the situation is dramatically different. In my view and long experience, physics is a multi-trillion dollars totally unregulated trade. To understand this trade, think about Wall Street, in which there are trillions of dollars of shares passed, transferred from one company to another without any governmental regulation at all. None. Only everything is decided by the individual company. So IBM, according to this view, IBM and General Motors and other big companies, they decide the value of their shares, and that's the way they are traded. Of course, this is not the case in Wall Street. Wall Street is very rigorously and rigidly regulated, and I know this indeed very well. It is the trade in science that is completely unregulated. At this moment, of course, I have immediate disagreement. Colleague says, but Dr. Santilli, but governmental agency, they control those trillion dollars all the way down to the penny. So yes, there is a control. Well, don't be blinded by this type of derailing, because I'm not referring to the control of how the trillions of dollars are spent. No, I'm referring to the academic process of establishing the value of the trade. We trade theories. That's the trade. The trade is in the theory. And the decision as to whether which theory is valid and which theory is invalid, that is which is totally unregulated and is left entirely to collegial decision. A bunch of academicians, they contact each other by email or phone or whatever, or they meet in a meeting and they decide, this is the theory that we want to push from now on, and that's the way it is. They have the power and they push it all the way to rather broad acceptance, not universal, but rather broad acceptance. This type of process, of course, due to the complete lack of any control of the trade of the exchange of the science, of course, is inevitably leads to political manipulation of physical evidence in favor of preferred theories. To illustrate this unregulated character of this trillion-dollar scientific trade, I must make a disturbing gesture. A gesture that will be disturbing to some, but not to all. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a disturbing gesture. This is the disturbing gesture. When Einstein followers see the squeezing of this ball, you can see the anguish in their eyes, because this is incontrovertible evidence that Einstein's special relativity is inapplicable to a certain segment of physical reality as limited capability. That's what they do not want. And therefore, this is the reason why this simple gesture, the formation of a ball, is never shown in any graduate school in virtually all over the world, with the exception of the graduate school on hadronic mechanics, PhD in hadronic mechanics, as well as a number of very advanced and indeed progressive PhD school. Why this gesture is so distressing? Well, it is distressing because not only it implies the inapplicability of special relativity, but also it implies the inapplicability of quantum mechanics. Indeed, both special relativity and quantum mechanics are known to be irreconcilably incompatible with the theory of deformation. And therefore, when you see this, when you show this to an Einstein follower or other colleagues who are sold on universal validity of quantum mechanics, you see the anguish in their face. And therefore, they oppose this topic as vigorously as possible. And that is why those are some of the consequences of having this trillion-dollar trade be unregulated. Why? Because the implications for society are substantial. This is just a symbol for the representation of a baryon, of a proton, or a neutron. There exists no perfectly rigid body in nature. All objects in nature are deformable. We can discuss the degree of the deformation under certain external forces. Yes, this is debatable, but not the existence of the deformability itself. Denying is straight corruption. And I want to state it very clearly because I want to have no part of it. So the issue is the following. The proton and the neutron are expected to be deformable. Ladies and gentlemen, the moment the academia admits that the proton and neutrons are deformable, the consequences, financial, academic, and otherwise, are really substantial. Why so? Because as an example, it implies that quantum mechanics is not exactly valid in the structure of nuclei. Quantum mechanics is not exactly valid in the structure of nuclei. Why so? Well, because this deformation implies the collapse of the very pillar of both special relativity and quantum mechanics, namely the rotational symmetry. Back in the early 90s, when I was visiting after the collapse of communism, when I was visiting Dubna, the Joint Institute for Nuclear Research in Dubna, I proposed a very simple model to represent exactly the magnetic moment of the simplest possible nucleus, the deuteron. based on what? On the assumption that the proton and the neutron experience a small deformation of about 1%. This is not in scale. And of the 1% deformation of the charge distribution, and consequently, any deformation of the charge distribution for spinning particles implies an alteration of the magnetic moment. If you do this, as we will see at the end of this lecture, the exact numerical representation, an invariant representation of the magnetic moment of the deuteron is instantaneous. Fine. But what happened with relativistic quantum mechanics? Well, I hope colleagues in good faith, experts in the field, will admit that relativistic quantum mechanics has been unable to achieve an exact representation of the magnetic moment of the deuteron, despite all possible relativistic and other correction. There is still 1% that still has escaped all possible attempt, to my best knowledge, short of drawing in the arbitrary function fitted from the value of the magnetic moment, arbitrary parameter, and this type of manipulation that are only assassinate science and create none. Notice also that the reduction of protons and neutrons to the hypothetical quarks complicates things and solve none, because the hypothetical orbits of the hypothetical quarks are too small to be polarized and achieve that missing 1%. Well, okay, now, why this thing has been strongly opposed? My God, because an alteration of the magnetic moment directly implies departure from the Lorentz-Poincaré symmetry, directly implies departure from special relativity, as indicated at the beginning. Well, let us enter into the details of the lecture. I have divided the lecture into three parts. Part one, the isotopy of the Lorentz-Poincaré symmetry. Part two, the isotopy of the spinorial covering of the Lorentz-Poincaré symmetry. And part three, some direct experimental verifications. The part three is, of course, a very important part as a complement of the new symmetry that we will be presenting in this lecture. What is the objective? The objective is to achieve a new type of symmetry that will allow the representation, for instance, of the Sun as being isolated from the rest of the universe, and therefore verifying the conventional total 10 Galilean or Poincaré conservation laws, yet admitting in its interior the most general possible non-non-non interaction, non-linear, non-local, and generally non-Hamiltonian, variational, non-self-adjoint interactions. Alternatively, one of the objectives of this lecture is the so-called historical open Lorentz problem, namely the universal invariance of locally varying speed of light within the physical media. Remember, for lecture 1A, for colleagues who did not have a chance to look at it, that the reduction of light to photons propagating through the water has been completely discredited, being totally political. The reason being, because with reduction there is no physics that you can do. There is no representation whatsoever of the angle of refraction, because the photon will scatter in all directions when they hit the surface of the water, and when they propagate through water will also equally scatter everywhere. There is no reason whatsoever they go in a straight line. This is politics, ladies and gentlemen. You have no possibility of representing the reduction of one-third of the speed of light. There is no possibility of reduction to photon electromagnetic waves with 1 meter wavelength, etc., etc., etc. So this experimental evidence, if treated scientifically, which means without political manipulation to adapt a physical reality to a beloved preferred theory, then forces the return to the Maxwellian conception of electromagnetic waves. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I am a physicist. I will never, ever accept the idea of waves existing and propagating without a universal medium, just because the universal medium could be perceived as being incompatible with special relativity. Ladies and gentlemen, I cannot do that. I want to separate myself from this type of political thinking. There is no wave that can exist in nature unless there is a medium that first creates it and second, propagates it. In this case, electromagnetic waves are created by the universal substratum known as the heater, which has an enormous energy density. It has been calculated that 1 cubic centimeter contains more energy than the energy contained in the entire sun. The return, however, to the Maxwellian conception implies a locally varying speed of light, as well, because only in this way we can indeed numerically represent experimental evidence such as this one and others. Very well, what is the technical objective of this lecture? The technical objective is to write down the most general possible reversible invariant that you can see here, and construct its universal symmetry. That's essentially the objective. This objective has been achieved years ago via the use of isomathematics. And the use of isomathematics, as you may remember from lecture 2b, require the identification of the fundamental quantity of isomathematics. That's the Santilli iso unit. Once you have the iso unit, the entire mathematics, isomathematics, is constructed uniquely and unambiguously, including iso numbers, iso fields, iso spaces, iso differential calculus, etc. In this case, there are many ways in which you can construct the iso unit. The one that I recommend, since this is the most general possible space-time, and therefore the topology is plus, 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 minus, then the proposal is, at least that's what we have done, there are other ways that I encourage to study, is that we factorize out of this general metric, we factorize the Minkowski metric, plus, plus, 1, 1, 1, 1, and minus 1. Once we factorize the eta from G, we end up with a 4x4 matrix, which is indeed positive, definite, because the non-compact topology has been absorbed by the Minkowski metric. Consequently, the inverse of that 4x4 matrix is indeed the iso unit of the theory, and it is positive, definite. Once you have done this, ladies and gentlemen, then you apply step by step isomathematics and you achieve the universal invariance of all infinitely possible, most general possible symmetric space-time. Very well, let's get going. I can only bring to your attention the most salient points, and this has to be studied in the existing literature to avoid it. Otherwise, I will need a semester. Well, the starting point, of course, is the Minkowski space, which is based on the field of real number, and then the metric we have just discussed, and of course the line element, the celebrated Minkowskian line element. But it is presented here in a different way. Notice that there is a multiplication by I, which is the Poincaré unit. What happened in the 20th century? What happened is that the field was based on the unit number 1, while the Poincaré algebra was based on the four-dimensional unit matrix 1, 1, 1, 1. So there was a differentiation of unit that nobody apparently noted. Well, this creates, on the isotopy, creates all sorts of inconsistencies. So to us, this popped up instantly to our eyes. And what we did, essentially, we unified the unit. Unit has to be one for the entire theory. You cannot have a unit for this, another unit for that, and so even though the difference seems to be trivial, then in reality is not. And so therefore, this has implied that the space-time coordinates are in reality isoscalar multiplied by this unit. It's trivial, but that's the way it is reinterpreted. Once you reinterpret the Minkowski line element in this way by factorizing the unit as in this expression, then immediately you can see that the Poincaré symmetry is 11-dimensional and not 10-dimensional. Because you multiply the metric, Minkowski metric, by any number, you multiply the unit by the inverse number, and this is an invariant. So this is a fundamental new invariant of space-time that I used for in a variety of new applications, including the new formulation of grand unification of electroweak and gravitational interaction. Very well, once you have the basic Minkowski space to construct what they call them the Minkowski-Santilli isospace, I proposed it for the first time at Nuovo Cimento in 1983, it is trivial. It is very simple because now you know the isotopic element thing. So you know the isounit. You know the isounit. So first you construct in that order. First you construct the isoreals. Once you know the isoreal, you construct the isometric. After you construct the isometric, you have to recognize that the coordinates have to be iso-coordinates, namely they have to be elements of the isofield. And then you recognize that the isotopic element is positive definite by assumption, by central assumption of this series. So therefore it can be diagonalized. And there are many different ways of diagonalizing. Usually this is the way the isotopic element is diagonalized, 1 over n1 square, 1 over n2 square, etc. The inverse, of course, is for the isounit. You do this in a very trivial way, and this is the final a new isotopic invariant. Let's look at it and see the consequences of this invariant. First of all, you see here that the speed of light is replaced by a Lorentz problem. Namely, the speed of light divided by the index of refraction, n4. Incidentally, not only you have the index of refraction here, but you also have the space counterpart, which are unavoidable. Even if you don't introduce them at the beginning, any transformation, even Lorentz transformation, will automatically create it. And so you cannot, they are intrinsic in the geometry, if you want so. But let's look at this in more detail. As we will see better in lecture 3b on the isotopy of special relativity, the Minkowski-Santilli isospace implies arbitrary causal speed, in particular arbitrary speed of light that can be as low than the speed of light in vacuum as desired, or can go as bigger than the speed of light in vacuum as desired. At this point, I have to recall this vociferous claim by Einstein followers that the speed of light in vacuum is the final causal speed throughout the entire universe under whatever possible condition may exist anywhere in the universe. I have to denounce it as political, and I have to defend Albert Einstein from possible complicity in this type of statement. Albert Einstein was very clear. He stated that the speed of light is indeed the ultimate limit of causal speed under three conditions. First, that it is for a point particle. You cannot have extended object in Einstein's special relativity. Number one. Number two, that the propagation is in vacuum. And number three, that the forces causing the acceleration are action at a distance, for instance, of electromagnetic character. Ladies and gentlemen, that statement by Einstein is indeed correct. And it is verified, in any case, in a daily basis nowadays, in particle accelerator. The politics for personal interest enters when those three conditions are removed. And the speed of light as the maximal causal speed is pushed as the final expression of causality throughout the universe, even under a condition in which there is no experimental verification at all. For instance, question, an electron in the core of a star that is evolving with the maximal causal speed given by the speed of light in vacuum, or the local speed is arbitrary. Ladies and gentlemen, the correct scientific statement is, we do not know. We do not know. That is a correct statement, scientifically. If we say, no, the speed of light is the maximum causal speed everywhere, that's politics, ladies and gentlemen. It must be denounced as politics. Again, on this business of the speed of light as the maximum causal speed, there has been horrendous politics going on that must be denounced because it suppresses the imagination of young mind and prevents discovery, advancement of human knowledge that in this case are crucial. For instance, the group of experimentalists in Germany propagated an entire symphony Beethoven symphony at a speed bigger than the speed of light in vacuum. It was done by propagating, it was done a typical interior condition, exactly as predicted by this geometry, by propagating light through certain media, the media given by special guides. Immediately, all Einstein followers all over the world unanimously, vociferously, no, this was only the phase velocity that was greater than the space, so there is no change whatsoever in the special relativity. Of course, all these authorities abused for one precise purpose, to maintain the validity of Einstein doctrine for all possible conditions existing in the universe. But ladies and gentlemen, I want to be on record by stating that one day, perhaps in this millennium, mankind will indeed reach the star despite the obstruction, the obstacle, the disqualifications and other intrusion by Einstein followers. They want to impose the validity of Einstein way beyond the condition of original conception and experimental verification. In any case, we already have available now purely mathematical model that at least, however, consistently predict and describe spaceship covering arbitrarily long distances at arbitrary speeds without fuel tank. I repeat, I hope to have time in some lecture on isogeometry to present geometric model of spaceship capable of covering any distance throughout the universe at whatever the speed desire without fuel tank. This seems to be crazy. It is not. Because, first of all, the fuel tank, you cannot reach the star with a fuel tank. If you need fuel to reach the star, forget about it. So you have to locate the source of energy during your travel to the star. The only source of energy is the ether. So if you tap this enormous amount of energy existing in the ether, ladies and gentlemen, you certainly need no fuel tank. Regarding arbitrary speed, the moment you establish contact with the ether, then those interactions are non-non-non. So therefore, special relativity does not apply. And the limitation of the speed of light in vacuum is no longer applicable. It makes no mathematical, physical, or conceptual sense. So you do have indeed arbitrary speed. And the arbitrary distance are obtained by contracting, by a geometrical contraction. We have to discuss this in separate time. Notice that when the ether is assumed as the universal substratum, there is no so-called ethereal wind. Indeed, one of my first paper that I wrote when I was an undergrad school is precisely to show that there cannot be an ethereal wind, because the electron is an oscillation of what? Oscillation of the ether. So when you propagate an electron, you move nothing material. You just transform. Move the 10 to the 20 pure oscillation from one point, you move it to a different point. Electron is an elementary particle. The same principle applies to all matter. So when you move matter through the ether, you move essentially the characteristic oscillation that creates the matter itself from one place to another. There cannot be any possible ethereal wind. However, this implies that matter is totally empty and the space is totally full, something that we can discuss at some other time. Very well, when people see this Santilli isotopy of Minkowski space, immediately jump at criticism. Of course, the intent is to derail, you know, it's something new, so let's knock it down. And the objection is, oh, it's based on four arbitrary constants, so it has no value. Well, ladies and gentlemen, this is again is a political criticism with no substance. Those four quantities, the ends, are called the characteristic quantities of the physical medium. And they have a very precise numerical value that are measured and are not arbitrary parameters. We have just said that N4 is the index of refraction. You cannot throw an arbitrary value there. No, depending on the speed of light. In a given medium, you calculate N4. The same for N1, N2, N3. However, what the primary function of those four parameters is to represent the anisotropy and inhomogeneity of physical media that we conceive. Those are anathema for special relativity that is centrally dependent on isotropic and homogeneous space-time. But inhomogeneity is clearly dependent on the local dependence of the characteristic quantity on the radius. Think about our atmosphere. The density varies with the elevation. The atmosphere is a beautiful example of inhomogeneity as well as anisotropy, because it rotates and creates, therefore, a medium which cannot possibly describe by the axiom of special relativity. But there is, incidentally, those characteristic quantities are normalized to the value 1 for the vacuum. And so in this sense, N4 can be conceived as a geometrization of the density of the medium. And N1, N2, N3, they have actually physical characteristics regarding the shape of the object itself, as we will see. In any case, the political character of the criticism that the characteristic quantities are arbitrary constant can be easily unmasked by showing that in the event the criticism is correct, then the famous Schwarzschild metric is trivial because characterized by four arbitrary constants. I repeat, the assumption that the characteristic quantity of the physical medium are arbitrary parameters implies that Schwarzschild has no meaning. Why so? Remember, the metric that we consider is the most universal you can think of in space-time. Schwarzschild is a very small particular case of the first metric that we wrote down in the first mathematical transparency. Indeed, you look at it and you can easily see that it's diagonal. The Schwarzschild is, of course, diagonal, it's symmetric. And therefore, you can easily see N3 is given by this celebrated element by Schwarzschild, and N4 is the inverse. So, as you can see, they are not parameter. In this case, they have a very deep geometrical meaning. Very well. Let's see the actual construction of the isotopies of the Lorentz Poincaré symmetry, called internationally now Lorentz Poincaré Santilli isosymmetries, plural, because there is an infinitely large class. Very well. First, again, let's review the conventional Lorentz Poincaré symmetry. This is a post-PhD level lecture. I don't think I have to enter into details, but those are the commutation rules, conventional commutation rules. Those are the Casimir invariant, in which I just added the unit is a trivial invariant in this case. And this is, of course, the structure of the Lie transformation group that characterizes the Lorentz Poincaré symmetry. By using the Lie isotopic theory that I proposed at Harvard, upgraded with the isomathematics of lecture 2b, then the construction of all infinitely possible isotopy of this structure is elementary. Of course, it is elementary now, but not when it was first derived at Nuovo Cimento in 1983. Well, first of all, the product, the Lie product, is replaced by the Lie Santilli isoproduct by sandwiching in between the isotopic element. But look, however, the important point here, look at here on the right-hand side, what's the difference, topological difference between here and there? Topological difference is that here you see the appearance of the most general possible metric that we have seen in the first technical transparency. In reality, it should be eta hat. In the literature, you'll find eta hat. By eta hat is at t multiplied by eta. So I prefer for this lecture to use g. Very well. And so the same for the isocasimir invariant. It's very easy to compute. Essentially, are given by sandwich the isotopic element of each and every product, and doing the various calculations, and see that the first isotopic invariant is, of course, the isounit. But careful, it's non-trivial now. That is an integral differential operator. and that represents variational non-self adjoint forces. So the invariance of that isounit is crucial for the consistency of the entire theory. And as a matter of fact, the entire isotopy of the Lorentz-Poincaré symmetry are constructed around the isounit precisely to assure the, its invariance. And the other second order and third order invariant are constructed very easily. This is just a simple isotopy of the second order invariant of the Lorentz-Poincaré symmetry. This is at the foundation of relativistic mechanics. And then similarly, the Lee-Santilli isotransformation are easily constructed. Notice that the isotopic element appearing in the exponent, again, as I emphasized, since lecture 2a was the crucial point that convinced me that the isotopes of Lithier are by far non-trivial, and therefore I kept doing them my way. Very well, let's now construct the isotopy of the Lorentz-Poincaré symmetry in each of its main part, beginning with isotopy of the rotational symmetry. Therefore, I have to remember this disturbing gesture that I initiated this lecture, namely the deformation of the sphere. Ladies and gentlemen, this is what we have to represent in an invariant way. We have to represent all infinitely possible the ellipsoidical and other deformation of the sphere. Not only classically, classically is trivial, but particularly at the level of elementary particles, so that we can extract eventually in due time new clean energies and fuel. Very well, in this case we use what is called the Euclid-Santilli isospace. This is essentially its element is the ellipsoid multiplied by the isounit, and at this moment you have to construct the isotrigonometric function. This requires a little bit of work that you have to study in the existing literature. Again, you have to identify the units of the angles. Remember, even the angles have to be isoangles. To define as isoangle, they are given by the product, the ordinary angle multiplied by its own isounit. And in this case, it turns out that the product N1, N2 is the isounit for the angle phi, and while the N3 is the isounit for the angle theta. So after doing this, it's very easy to derive the isotrigonometric function, which are at the foundation of the isorotational symmetry. And those are the isospherical coordinates. They look innocuous in a mathematical exercise. Ladies and gentlemen, I have no word to disagree, because those have very deep and unreassuring implication, for instance, for the scattering theory. Because now they use angles in the scattering theory. Well, they have to be subjected for the invariance of the scattering itself under the admission of non-non-non interaction in the hyperdense scattering region. As you can see from here, they have a different interpretation of what has been provided via the use of the conventional scattering theory. We will see this in some other lecture. So then you use the rules of Lee-Santilli transformation group and very easily construct the rotation here in two dimensions. I cannot do it in three dimensions. It is done on my book on elements of hadronic mechanics in all details, in all possible dimensions. I recommend it. It's very easy to prove that isotopic rotational symmetry is isomorphic to the conventional symmetry. But this is a little bit unsettled, because the rotational symmetry only holds for the perfect sphere. Here we are talking about all possible ellipsoidical deformation of the sphere. So how can the rotational symmetry remain invariant for all possible deformation of the sphere? This is basically the issue. The answer is the so-called isosphere, namely the perfect sphere in an isospace over an isofield. In essence, what happens is the following, that we start from a perfect sphere. We deform the sphere into the ellipsoid. By doing so, we change the unit radius, we change into the n1 square and n2 square. Jointly, we change the corresponding unit by the inverse, and therefore, those two changes, they compensate each other and the ellipsoid appears an ellipsoid only in our space-time. But on isospace over isofield, this ellipsoid is indeed the perfect sphere. As a matter of fact, if the image of the ellipsoid were not possibly the perfect sphere on isospace, it would be easy to prove this lemma to be wrong, that namely that isotopic rotational symmetry cannot be isomorphic to the spherical, to the conventional rotational symmetry. Let's move now to the Lorentz symmetry. Again, you do you apply the theory of Lie isotopic groups and easily construct the covering of Lorentz transformation here in two dimension. For arbitrary dimension is in my book on elements of hadronic mechanics, and again it's very easy to see that this expression here Lie indeed invariant, the very first universal space-time invariant. They originally wrote in two dimension, of course. It's also very easy to prove that what is called the Lorentz-Santilli isosymmetry are all isomorphic to the conventional symmetry. Again, there is a dichotomy because the Lorentz symmetry only holds, for as well known, for the perfect light cone that sets, you know, the causality for the speed of light as the maximal causal speed. So in reality, the light cone that we have is this one. For instance, in our atmosphere, the speed of light changes continuously because of the change of the density with the elevation and other reason, the anisotropy and so on. So this the wiggly cone is the real cone in our. And so how can it's possible that Lorentz still remain valid for this wiggly cone? Well, it's the same. It's the same principle as for isosphere. It's called the light isocone. You start from here. You change which the axes are one and one. It's 1 second, 1 centimeter. You change those. You deform those axes by multiplying them for n1 and n3 and n4 in this case. Jointly, the corresponding units are lifted by the inverse value. Automatically, you have necessarily an invariance, namely, in this wiggly cone, when seen on Minkowski-Santilli isospace, is the perfect cone to such an extent that even the angle is 45 degrees. So, on Minkowski-Santilli isospace, the maximal causal speed is the speed of light. I repeat, on the isospace over an isofield, the maximal causal speed is the speed of light in vacuum. However, that is a mathematical formulation. The arbitrary value of the speed of light occurs when you project that mathematical treatment that is used for invariance, when you project it in our space-time. So the projection then gives you an arbitrary speed. And look at this. The identity is such that you can even write by putting a hat on the coordinates, so you don't see any difference between the conventional light cone and the and the light isocone. Very well, let's keep going. Then let's look at the translation. Look at the translation here. They are very four-dimensional. They are highly nonlinear, as we expect to be, because we are after a non theory, nonlinear, non-local, non-Hamiltonian, non-potential, etc. And this appears to be in contradiction with the fact that the linear momentum isocommute. You see, by remember the structure constant of the Poincaré symmetry are preserved in this presentation that we are dealing with. And so why then, under the isocommutativity still we have a nonlinear realization? Well, we do, because if you go in the conventional space, Minkowski space, then the linear momentum in this formulation no longer commute. And indeed, we started with the most general possible metric, which includes curvature as one of many different, much more complex notion. So certainly the linear momentum are not expected to commute conventionally. Very well. And then finally we have the isotopic isodilation or isotopic invariance still as an undefined name. Again, if we change the isometric, we multiply by an arbitrary quantity, and corresponding the isounit is multiplied by the inverse, the isotopic line element remains invariant. Therefore, we have the theorem that both the Lorentz-Poincaré symmetry as well as all infinitely possible isotopies are 11 dimensional. Contrary to a belief throughout the entire 20th century that the Poincaré symmetry was only 10 dimensional.